Hello, this is Jackie B. Peterson. I'm your host today on our Solo Pro Radio show. I'm the author of Better, Smarter, Richer, Seven Business Principles for Encore, Creative, and Solo Entrepreneurs. And it's my business to help solos, those of you in one-person businesses, find the financial success you are looking for in your businesses. So I hope you'll go to the website, bettersmarterricher.com. You can download my book, which is a fill-in-the-blanks workbook. I want you to do the work and think about what it is you need to change your habits and become more financially successful. You can also join the conversation on our blog, sign up for our free newsletter, and find out about coming events. So let me tell you about a couple coming events. I'm going to do one of my free symposiums called The Principles of Solopreneurship on April 16th, 6 to 9 p.m. at the PCC Auditorium in Southeast Portland. You can check it out there. I'm also going to be part of two Work After 50 symposiums that we're putting on with AARP and the Small Business Administration, April 22nd and April 24th. So if you're an Encore seeking Work After 50, be a good thing for you to attend, and attendance is free, free at all of the events I've talked about. So today, I'm talking with Karen Sands. Karen left corporate America at the peak of her career. She'd become a visionary change agent, an expert in America's graying trend and its impact on the future. Today, Karen is the aging expert and professional futurist, an ICF-certified master coach and mentor, and a CCE board-certified coach. As the everyday futurist, she uses scientific, strategic, and intuitive forecasting skills and tools to help her clients capitalize on tomorrow's trends today so they can achieve personal, professional, and global transformation while monetizing a future that matters. This is going to be an interesting conversation. Hello, Karen.
Hi, Jackie. I'm glad to be here, and it will be an interesting conversation, I assure you.
Oh, I think so. This is just fabulous. So I love hearing what you're doing because I think it's fabulous to be the everyday futurist. But before we get to that, talk about your journey. Like, where did you grow up? What did you study in school, and what work did you do in your corporate career?
I think really what comes through my entire life story, and it's something I teach about no matter who I'm working with, is that our true purpose, our true path, what I really call our true greatness, our DNA, what we're encoded to be here for, is forged through change and crisis. And that's really how my career has unfolded. It's not something where I intentionally said, well, I'm going to go do this and be this, and that's it for the rest of my life. In fact, like most of us, especially boomers and those of us on the cusp of boomerhood, life brings us doors to open, and it depends which doors we go through, which risks we take, you know, risk versus being risky. And that's true throughout my career. I started as a science and health educator and was rather much of a pioneer in the educational world back in the mid to late 60s and had a great time. It was wonderful. But I got bored. You know, I reached that ceiling and said, okay, now what do I do? Where do I want to be next? So I didn't at that time say, gee, I want to be a futurist. Gee, I want to be a businesswoman. Gee, you know, it just didn't work that way. And I don't think it does for many of us today because everything's been torn down. You know, we're in pain and anguish of, okay, what's the world about now? What's the future going to be about? Who do we become? And that's when we have to leave ourselves open to what comes towards us, what doors open. One of my many, many mentors in life, I've been very fortunate. But Buckminster Fuller used to talk about what we call right angle precession, meaning you can go along in a straight line and you'll get to where you think you're headed. But in reality, what you need to pay attention to are the right angles. And it doesn't mean right every right angle, every door you open
right.
is the right door, but it's the door to test and see if it is.
Oh, that's so interesting.
Yeah, and I that plays out in everyone's life and career if they step back and take a look. You'll see that the missed opportunities are usually the messengers, opportunities that come that we go in and close that door without even peeking in. Mm-hmm. So it's important to pay attention to that, to always be looking. So I started out in education. And then I decided, I became a mom, and I said, you know, this isn't enough for me. I was very antsy, and it was, of course, the very beginning of the women's movement. So I was getting permission to express that I wanted to do more than, in addition to, alongside of, being a mom.
Uh-huh.
And I started a growth center. At first, it was just for women. It was a women's women's movement center, if you would. But we weren't waving flags or burning bras. We were just women, many of us moms, many of us in the workforce, others of us not stay-at-homes, trying to figure out who were we and what was our voice. And it's interesting that I find today that is happening all over again.
Yes,
you know,
it
hasn't gone away. It's just come back up and maybe even louder. And so back then, that was very interesting because in a year's time, I had over 1,000 members of this center.
Wow.
Never expected that to be happening, of course. But what was so wonderful was it initiated me into the Women's Life Course because I saw women from all ages and stages and cycles and what the issues were. And I was so impassioned and taken by it. I did not know that this would be a thread throughout the rest of my life, of course. But at that time, it was very, very rich for me. And then men started coming, which seems to happen to me all the time. So when we tell our clients about target marketing and picking a target market, sometimes the universe says, this is coming in also. So, you know, don't shut things down. You don't want to do everybody, but you want to pay attention. So, as I said, men started coming. These were, you know, career professionals, entrepreneurs, CEOs, men and women, all different kinds. So it was a fascinating time. And then I decided, well, do I get an MBA or do I do my own thing? You know, I have two young kids. What do I want to do? And this is just when women were going back to school to get MBAs or law degrees or MDs or whatever. And so I started my own business, and I won't go into that for too much depth, except, again, which I found in my life, and I believe most boomerpreneurs now need to pay attention to, is I was cause-driven. I had to have purpose and meaning to what I was doing. And so for me at that time, it was to bring women back in the workforce, women who were at home, many of them popping pills, you know, drinking alcohol, bored to tears. And I created a really successful business in getting women out there running their own businesses. It was very, very exciting. And then something happened. And this is what I mean. We don't always intentionally choose. I got a phone call from my mom. I was at home, you know, probably washing dishes. I remember I was in the kitchen. And two young kids watching probably Sesame Street at that time. And I picked up the phone. I said, hey, hi, Mom. Now, I didn't have, a thing that said, hey, your mom is calling like we do now. But I said, hi, Mom. And she said, hello, back. And I said, what's up? What's going on? And she said, I have something to tell you. I said, sure. You know, I'm, you know, young. I'm in, my, you know, like my late, no, I guess I was in my mid to late 20s by then. I was 20, maybe I was 28 by then. in any case, she said, well, I drove my car into a toll booth. Naturally, I was stopped in my tracks. You did
what? Yeah.
And she repeated it again, and being young and naive at the time, I asked the dumbest questions, like, why did you do that, instead of saying, oh, my God. But it was, why did you do that? And she answered in such a telling way. She said, because the voices on the radio told me to.
Oh, goodness.
And in that moment, my oh, goodness, my oh, God was, oh, my God, my life, her life is forever changed.
Wow.
And it was then that I owned, you know, here I am 28 and she was far younger than I am now, that she had Alzheimer's and there was no turning back. There was no denying it. And of course,
oh
it
my
got
goodness.
Much worse. But the key to that story is not for a shock benefit, but rather that the shock benefit it gave me was that it changed my life forevermore.
Oh, I imagine.
Yeah. It
That's
changed
so young,
my direction.
How to deal with that.
It changed, well, and not only the caretaking aspect, but in terms of the impact on my life and my perspective, I chose in that moment in time that I never wanted my life to be wasted, that I might not have that time, that I might end up as my mom.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And so I wanted to do everything I could that would be loud, that would make mm-hmm. a difference, that would have an impact on the future for my kids and my grandkids and generations on. And so it definitely turned me. I left a marriage that was not working. I moved my business. I moved on it over the next 2 years or so, 2 or 3 years. I moved into corporate America. If you had ever told me that I would have become a corporate executive, I would have cracked up. That was never in the cards, right?
Yeah.
Well, it was very much in the cards. I ended up, I spent much like many of you will go through who are listening, I spent 9 months, and back then this was not done. I was pretty bold and brave, I guess. I was young and foolish. So I ended up interviewing with no jobs. I didn't want a job. I didn't want anything. I just wanted to know what I should be doing, where I should be going, where I should be headed. So I interviewed with CEOs and, you know, board members and entrepreneurs, all over the board, all different industries, men and women. And they were so gracious. Yeah. I learned more in those 9 months than that people in whole careers, 30 years of careers learn. Because I learned which way to go, what was important, what to value, what of my strengths to bring forward. And I brought that through everything I've done, because when I did the Growth Center, I had also then became a certified career counselor. So it all kind of wrapped together by the time I, you know, made these choices. And so I found a company that was willing to take really a bet on me. Because I told them I knew what I was doing. I knew about entrepreneurs and solo entrepreneurs. I knew about especially women entrepreneurs, and that I could get to that market for them. Well, it turned out it was financial services. I won't name the company now. A major financial services company. And where did I end up? I landed in retirement services and planning.
Oh, my goodness.
Yes. Now, here I am. I'm 32. I don't even know what a pension is. I didn't stay in education long enough to get one, right? So it meant absolutely zilch to me. Well, I then, of course, had to study not only the markets that we were going for, but also what is this? And what is retirement planning and saving? Why do we even need to know about this stuff, right? Needless to say, that's when my futurist career started, because then I became a pro in this and was called that for the company, because I was looking at the trends. You asked me, and one of the questions to think about responding to was, what is a futurist? I don't look at a crystal ball. You know, I'm not predicting, because there is no one that can actually predict the future. And if they do, walk away fast, actually run.
Right.
But you study what has been, what has the past been, what are the trends, what is emerging, what do we see, what are the scenarios that may be coming forward, so that we can guide and make more conscious, better decisions in the choices we make. In any case, so I did that, but at the time it was totally within the realm of the graying of the globe as well as of America, which I had known nothing about. So it tied in without my realizing into the story of my mom. I then went on to become a real major change agent and what they called a new breed leader at the time, and this was in the late 70s and early 80s when I got labeled with that one. Also was called the Velvet Whip. I trained over 8,000 agents and advisors, as well as the key NASD folks, professionals that worked with them. So it was a very, very exciting time. I got to basically do everything I wanted, but the most important part for me was cultural change, organizational change, systemic change, which was very powerful. And so it satisfied for me the soft side and the hard side of me and of my work. And it was just a great time to be a woman in this company, because they allowed me to be visible. They allowed me and supported me to do so. I became the protege of the chairman of the board and the president and blah, 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 blah. So I got great opportunities, but I also took them by the horns, and I stood out and asked for what I wanted and said, this is where I think we should be going and what we need to be doing. Women need to do that. We know all of this.
Right.
We know
all
of this. So that's how I became a futurist, and that's how I got in another level of the field of aging. And then I had some other pretty amazing, happenings. It's kind of hard to explain them because they came from nowhere, messengers that basically led me to some choices. And I won't take the time now because they're pretty startling to tell just over on the, you know, radio interview. But what it caused me to do was to leave my corporate career at the height of it. I was winning awards. I was breaking all the rules and breaking all the records in terms of selling retirement planning services, et cetera, and to the entrepreneur market, the small and medium-sized business market.
That in itself was an important piece of work with what's happened with the markets and with people's retirement planning. I mean, you
absolutely
probably have a lot of people today who are very grateful for the work that you did, you know, those years ago, getting them started
in
retirement
so
planning.
Yeah, I hadn't looked at it that way, so thank you, Jackie. That's very sweet. But what came out of it was I said, okay, I'm done. I got to do everything that I ever dreamed of doing in corporate America at a very young age.
Mm-hmm.
And it was now, what do I want to do? You know, I had my legs up on, you know, feet up on the fuchsia, seriously enameled table with brass edging. I had it all. You know, corner office and the whole bit. And I said, this isn't it. It doesn't feed my soul. I feel torn and parched and entrenched. And I mean, I was doing really cool things, you know, cross-fertilization across silos, all the stuff that people were not talking about back then. But it still wasn't feeding me. So I left.
Yeah, you're looking for meaning.
Yes. There was something deeper. It was more than meaning because I had a lot of meaning. I don't mean to correct you. I'm just thinking it through as you said it. I had a lot of meaning in what I did and a lot of value. I mean, it was a tremendous experience for me and for the people that worked with me and who I adored. But it was more there was something else was calling me.
Mm-hmm.
And it certainly wasn't bringing my briefcase home, you know, 7 days a week. And I had a daughter that was leaving for college in a year and a son that was in high school. But, you know, something was pulling at me, and a fabulous new marriage at the time. We're now 38 years together, so at the time, yeah. But so it's something deeper, and that's something I want us all, even after and within the ending, I hope, of the Great Recession, that we remember to pay attention to those callings. They are so incredibly important. So, but what I did, I left and I said, so what do I want to do? Gee, I have a whole portfolio of skills.
Right, the world was open.
Right, and I didn't know what to do with it. I had not a clue. Here I had been coaching people in corporate, coaching people out of corporate, you know, on the side, all of it, but I still didn't know what I wanted. And then I had some experiences that called to me, that said to me, go back to what was so meaningful to me, which was aging and what had happened to my mom and all the things that came after it that seemed to tie together. So in 1994, I got one of the first postgraduate certifications in gerontology, adult development, and aging.
Oh, great.
Yes, and that was in 94. At that time, I don't think there were any master programs, and I know for sure there were no PhD programs.
Mm-hmm.
So this, especially not in the East. And so this was through Hunter University, the Brookdale Center on Aging. It was a fabulous program, and I was very fortunate. Rick Moody, which you may have heard of, or Harry Moody, as he's known professionally, was my mentor and advisor and professor. It was a fabulous turn. And I went to him and I said, I don't understand something. Everything that we're taught, everything that I read is all about the dis-ease of aging.
Yes.
It's the dis-ease model, the dysfunctional, you know, going into non-existence model.
Right.
It was not about positive aging and certainly not about conscious aging. And he gave me the opportunity to teach the first conscious aging courses to professionals in the field back in the 90s. So,
how wonderful.
It was fabulous. And I've only gotten to see him the last couple of years at a few conferences, so it's been a great reunion. But in any case, so all of this was tying together, you know, what had started so long ago, and I had not seen the thread. So that's what I mean about sometimes it's not conscious. Sometimes you have to open up to what comes forward and trust that it is coming together because it will. So all my work in futuring has remained, and all my work in the aging field has come together. And only recently, you know, I've called myself the Everyday Futurist for a long, long time because I wanted to translate complex issues into everyday understanding.
Cool.
Yeah, and so and I wanted to bring it down to our level, to everyday level, and that's what I do in my work, obviously. And I was just trying to remember where I was going with this. I said what a futurist was. I know you wanted to know.
Yeah, well, that's okay. But, you could explain that some more because I think that's terribly interesting, and I love how you came to be doing this. You know, Karen, I've been 2.5 years doing this radio show once a week, and I've got to tell you, every solo I have talked to tells a story that if you, you know, when they're in it, they're moving from one thing to another thing to another thing, and they can hardly see how they all connect. But when they've gotten to the stage where they are now, they look back and they see how they all make sense and that everything that they've done in their past has been a tool that they have used to be presenting themselves in the world the way they are now. Every single tool has mattered.
Exactly.
And I hear you saying the same thing. All of this skill, all of these experiences have now come together, and you are practicing as the everyday futurist, and you're also applying that to, I'm gathering, to people in their encore years who are saying, okay, how does this all fit, and what do I do now, and, you know, how's this going to work? Is that what's going on?
Exactly. Yes, and my clients are primarily evolving, you know, existing, evolving business owners, or they're aspiring entrepreneurs.
Yes.
They're definitely conscious. Either they're conscious or they're seekers of consciousness. I'm not light, you know. I move very fast in my work and very deep, depending on where someone's coming in, obviously. So I tend to work with people who are very savvy, very experienced. They may not know what they want to do next, but they're still savvy and very conscious and very experienced. And visionary leaders for sure. Now the thing that always comes up is people say, I'm not a visionary. You know, that's not me. But I want everyone to understand that a term that I have applied for many, many years is that we are now in an epical shift. We are in what I call the age of greatness. And that greatness is not something ethereal or ephemeral. It is, in fact, each of us, I truly believe this deep in me, each of us is DNA coded to why we are here on this planet, what our destiny is. What is our song to be sung? And then,
I love the way you say that. You know, I have to tell you that I started a new Better, Smarter, Richer study group yesterday, and we had exactly this conversation about how important it is to be doing that which you are meant to do. And one of the ways to know that is by identifying where your passion is. Where is your heart? Where are you being pulled forward? And I said, aren't we lucky to be living in the what we're calling the longevity bonus, where we can do all of these things in our lives to gain this experience and then recreate ourselves as a person who is going to use all of those insights and all of those experiences to bring to the world a wonderful thing that they were really meant, you know, what they're really here to do. This is what you're really meant to be here doing.
Exactly.
And we're getting to do it.
And I find that for women, even more so, because, you know, we're coming out in such enormous numbers. This is the most exciting time to be a woman.
Yes.
There is so much clout that we have, and we don't have to be afraid now of stepping out and voicing, of using our voices and bringing that into the work we do as well as into every relationship we have. And so most of my work is definitely targeted towards women, especially women who are entrepreneurs or wannabe and solopreneurs, et cetera, and visionaries all. But again, the men always come because there are men who are seeking that same inner conscious feminine to come forward. And so it's very exciting when that happens. And in fact, my practice, it turns out, is 50-50. I have 50% men and women,
So, Karen, how do they work with you? I mean, somebody finds you, and what do they say? That they're trying to figure out what to do next or where to go with their life? Or,
well,
how does that work?
Well, it's changed with the Great Recession. Mm-hmm. You know, boomers were doing awesome things, and they thought they were pretty awesome, too.
Yes.
And then the Great Recession hit, and everything tumbled, which is really the fall of the patriarchy. It's a slow death, but it's happening.
Yes,
you know, we flipped the pyramid, hopefully, more and more.
Yes.
And so people were coming, might be just doing fine, and they wanted to, you know, get a promotion, or they wanted to just go up the ladder, or they just wanted to make their business take it to another level, you know, performance-based as well as quality of life,
mm-hmm.
course, and continuous improvement. But now, because the time now is so critical for us to take action, both for the planet as well as for our society and for ourselves, now I find people are coming either down on their knees, you know, been brought to their knees by the Great Recession and saying, okay, where do I go? What do I do? Who am I? There's that group.
Mm-hmm.
And then there are those who were not scathed, even though they may know many who were, but who were not scathed and are saying, okay, you know, I'm doing good enough, but now I really want to go for it. And there
mm-hmm.
are others who are really doing well, top of
mm-hmm.
their field, making tons of money, and saying, you know, something's missing. There's something else I'm reaching, and to me that's greatness. It's always greatness calling us forward at every level and for everyone in different ways. But so they come at different places. And, you know, even if I say I'm executive coaching, the reality is it's personal and professional mastery. That's what all of this is about. Because if you haven't worked on that for yourself, if you haven't been developing your own consciousness, you're not going to be a conscious business leader.
Right.
So it comes together. It all comes together, and it always comes out. You know, I remember one guy came to me who thought for sure that it was his partners, that he was in a big, big firm that they had created and grown, that was the cause of his dissatisfaction. Well, it was not the cause of his dissatisfaction. A broken marriage of over 30 years, which was destroying him on an inner level, was actually the cause. So you just, you know, you don't know till somebody shows up. And you move through it. You know, you just move through it to see what it is. But
So is your process one of, you know, somebody hires you and you're talking with them and then you proceed to do a whole series of interviews or there must be an interview process of some sort. Is that how you work with people?
Well, it is, but people find me by a variety of ways. They find
mm-hmm.
me by reading my books, by reading my articles on my blogs,
mm-hmm.
or hearing
mm-hmm.
me speak. So it depends how they come. Or they may be referred, you know, by a wife, or they may be referred by a best friend. I mean, it varies, you know.
Uh-huh.
They just come from all different directions, really. And, yes, I listen. You know, it's what I've always said is I have the right questions to ask. And some of that comes from my scientific background, from my psychological background, from my, you know, from all of it, from the futurist background, because that's what we do. We break assumptions. That's
mm-hmm.
what futurists do. We break assumptions. We love doing that. So they come that way, and I respond by the listening and the questions. There are a lot of people that will tell you what to do, and that's not what you need. What you need
mm-hmm.
is to be heard and listened and then be asked the right questions. The other part of it, which I know you're sure to ask me, is how do I bring the futuring work in it? Well, futuring
right, exactly.
has so many
how do you
different
do that?
Aspects. Yeah, it has so many different aspects. But I'm always holding the container of what the current trends are in
right.
terms of someone is looking for, okay, what business do I go in or which market do I go after? That's there. There. But there's another piece of it, which I'm going to say lightly, and it is not light, it's very deep actually, is scenario planning, which I know people now are more familiar with that terminology. But as futurists, we're always looking at breaking the assumptions and then creating scenarios of what might be based on what we know and the trends that are moving forward, right? So
mm-hmm.
I'm giving this in a broad picture, of course, broad brush. But when we do that, we then can begin to create what I call an aspirational future.
Ah.
And in the field of aging, being a gerofuturist, I would refer to that as an aspirational ageless future, because that's what my body of work in the aging field now is all about, is about ageless futures. And this is the time to create them. So we begin to look at what is that aspirational future? And we dig into it, and then we back out and then back in. What are the skill gaps? You know, what do you need to do to get there? Who do you need to speak, et cetera, et cetera. All the typical career and business planning steps that you take, but within a context that no one's really typically looked at for themselves or been asked to look at or have had the people who are experienced enough to ask them those questions.
Let me ask a question here. So when you're talking about an ageless future, are you talking about, and maybe both, one for the person with whom you are working or with society as in general that we shift away from the rampant ageism that has taught a lot of people so that they're seeking work and they can't even get an interview? I mean,
yes, all of the above and more, yes.
Okay.
Yes, absolutely. Your folks that are listening can go to agelessfutures.com and check it out. I have tons of free material, tons of giveaways of information for them to go through and explore and engage in. So, yeah, please do.
Okay, yeah, repeat
so it's all
that.
Of
ageless
what you
futures
described.
Or ageless future?
Ageless futures.
Okay, with an S.
Yes.
Okay.
.com. Thank you.
Okay.
But I want to go back to two about the trends and the trends I'm seeing.
Yes.
As a futurist, and also as a transformational futurist, not a typical traditional futurist. And so I look at things that I see as moving through, and I'm going to say them, and as I say them, I want to stress that both highly evolved men, being more conscious and in touch with their inner world, would fit into this category and would be the proponents of this, but women need to be at the forefront. This is so natural for who we are as feminine beings. So as I state them quickly, I want you to take that in from the lens of who you are if you're listening and you're a woman.
Okay.
This is why you are the future visionaries. You are now the visionaries that we need. So one of the first trends is, and it's been coming for a long, long time, slowly and quietly on the edges, is the arising of the inner conscious feminine, that inner part of us that intuits, that is emotive, that senses, that has an inner knowing, that is sort of between time and timelessness and sees, almost like the oracles of the old times. And it's growing and growing and growing. It's coming in dream time. There's a lot of that in dream time and stories that people are repeating. It is showing up and showing up and showing up. It's very, very exciting. The next is a conscious capitalism and a conscious leadership, conscious business. Some of us have talked about this for decades, but now it's showing up more and more. And in short form, that's really about businesses or leaders that are making a positive difference, that are dedicated to having their companies, especially solopreneurs, that make a positive difference. Now, whether it's a positive difference in society as a whole or in a community or in a locality, it can be all of those and more. And
yes, I am seeing that a lot.
Yes, and it's coming on strong. It's very, very exciting. And I think the millennials have a big
yes, the millennials and the share economy are a huge part of that.
Yes. So that then goes into purpose-driven or values-based cultures and organizations. Boomers, as well as Gen Xs and millennials, et cetera, are looking for that. They want to work for organizations or for institutions or entities or their own that are totally tied into purpose and value-based, totally. And in fact, there was I forget where I read this, but there was a study and it said that almost two-thirds of folks want to work for organizations that are making a positive difference.
Yes.
And I would say that's probably true in terms of our buying power as well.
Yes.
And I know there are some stats on that I don't have on the top of my head.
Yes, and the rise of the B Corp, for instance.
Yes, exactly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Exactly. And then the next would be like human-centric. When I was teaching, I'd call it pupil-centric or student-centric. In corporate, I'd call it customer-centric and employee-centric. Now let's talk about it human-centric. Everything is about who we are and what we need, not what we're told we need by some organization or product purveyor. And the other is collaboration. This is the culture of the 21st century. This is women, women, women. We know how to do this. So it's innate to us. It's collaboration. It's not just the mobile devices, which helps, of course, but it's creating across generation. This is something I'm a very big proponent of, I feel so passionate about, is that we as the, what I call visionaries with wrinkles, we need to be the ones to put our hands out and to create dialogue and discourse, not discord, with the younger generations. We need as multiple generations to reshape the future. And so we now need to collaborate. But first we need to talk. We need to create those dialogues. All this boomer bashing stuff has got to be stopped. Because it's nonsense. It has nothing to do with the truth.
It is. It is nonsense. Yeah. And the boomer generation has a lot of wisdom to offer. And so does the millennial generation have a lot of wisdom to offer. We need to collaborate on it.
Exactly. And we need to be the ones, therefore, to put our hands out the olive.
Yes, we do.
You would. But then the next is what we call beta entrepreneurship and futuring. And it means it's different from what we've had before in entrepreneurship. And so I want the people who are listening who are considering and are already solo entrepreneurs is that it's a process of trial and error. And out of that process, it's like the doors I talked about opening before. It's trying things out. And out of that, something will work. And there'll be what we call disruptive innovation. It will disrupt what was.
Yes.
You know, Apple's been great at that, right? So this is what we are doing, and this is the way business is going to be, entrepreneurship is going to be. And the biggest part I love the best is women mean business. We are the ones that are needed, and we're producing in every country that's looked at leadership by women, the GDP has gone up significantly. Every company that has us on boards or in leadership positions is doing better. So it's our time. It is our time. But the best part to me is the women who are 50 plus.
Yes.
Talk
about that. I totally agree with you, but talk about that.
Yeah. We are the women we've been waiting for. We are the visionaries we've been waiting for. We are at the forefront of this epical big shift. It's our time to make the future happen, to reshape it. And we're in all the right places to do this now. The right places to do this.
Yes. I feel like 2013 was a year, and maybe even 2012 were years of getting things in place.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I could see a lot of people and situations getting positioned.
Yes.
And now 2014, we're going to begin taking advantage of that.
Yes, exactly.
You know, I'm
exactly.
really coming forth and really stepping out and really being visible and articulate and seen and heard and public about what we're talking about.
It's
an interesting time, and it's right now.
It's been a very exciting time to be here. Very, very exciting time.
So you're thinking that, you know, women, and particularly boomers, women 50-plus, it's not only appropriate and wonderful for them to be encore entrepreneurs and keep working, but it's almost like a privilege, and even more than a privilege, it's an opportunity, and it's almost a requirement in a sense that they step forth now.
Absolutely.
I mean, this shouldn't be a surprise.
Yes, and in fact, I wrote, off of my 1994 gerontology degree, I was writing a dissertation, and I began it, this is now 24 years ago probably, and 22 years ago, whatever it was, but I began a study interviewing women, all women over 60 at the time, and this was new. No one was doing this sort of thing back in the mid-90s.
No, nobody wanted to admit they were even on the planet.
Right, exactly. Well, and for me, it came again out of what had happened with my mother and the questions I was asking about what does it mean to be an older woman? Who am I going to be? What will my future be? What impact will I have?
Right.
And so I started doing those interviews in some ways self-serving, but also for overall research. And as I did focus groups and other events like that, all of the people I was working with at the time, you know, were in their 30s, 40s, maybe 50s, some in their 60s, some in their 20s. And they could care less. You know, it was the wrong. Boomers did not want to hear about it. And so I put that work away, and it's a long story, so I won't tell it all now. But several years ago, I guess about 6 years ago, I was out in Arizona, And I was meeting all these different people, very sharp professionals and entrepreneurs and business leaders, et cetera. And I started noticing that a lot of them, mostly women, but not all, would ask me questions that I was asking, as if I was this font of information, of knowledge. And suddenly I realized, oh, my God, I'm the crone. I am now the crone. They're asking me these questions,
right?
These questions I had asked so many, many decades before. And when I went home, I realized that it was time now to bring that work forward and to update it, you know, add more and more interviews, which I did. And there's a lot of wonderful story around this that we don't really have time for, I'm sure, today. But I then created the book, my book that I brought out in 2012, called Visionaries Have Wrinkles.
I love that.
Yeah, and that's the reaction I get all the time. And it's, I wanted conversations with women, because you mentioned about visibility, to understand that there are many women out there who are invisible, or should I say under the radar, not totally invisible by any means, but under the radar, who are making change and impact and reshaping the future. So one of the questions that I kept hearing all those many years and recently, of course, still is the concern around us being invisible and irrelevant. And that's men and women, but especially women. We're feeling this and stating this and bemoaning it. And my answer is, sometimes the greatest positive impact is when we are quietly and invisibly out of the public eye making shifts and changes that have long-term generational impact. So I don't want women to feel that you have to be out there on the stage. Some of us do. I love it. Obviously,
well, and you know, and it's a corollary to that, Karen, that when you are quietly going about your business and maybe not attracting big national attention, what that means is you don't have anyone stopping you either. You know? I mean, it's you can operate without people saying, you can't do that.
Right.
We don't do that this way here. We've never done that before. Stop doing that. You know, all the things that prevent positive change from taking place, it doesn't happen to you because you're quiet and you're under the radar, and eventually enough people making these changes, it will rise to the surface.
Exactly.
You can't help it. But by then it's too late to stop it.
Exactly. And by collaborating, that's even more so the case.
Yes. Yes. Oh, how wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
This is just fabulous. So Visionaries Have Wrinkles is available on your website.
It is available in the store on my website, but it's also on all the major retailers like Amazon, et cetera. It's there. What's also very exciting, especially for those of us in the field of aging, what came out of this, because I, of course, I've been touring the whole country on this for several years now, and I kept noticing several things that I want to talk about if we have time. One is, I'm also a TED, I don't know if you know about the TED Fellows from the TED Talks, you know, the Fellows are those that are selected every year for them to be fully developed and supported by TED. And I'm one of the master coaches for that group of people, and it's been a very exciting experience. But what I noticed is they confirmed what I've seen in the general public of the rest of us ordinary, extraordinary people, is that you could have a vision, but you have to also know and learn and be taught how to monetize it.
Yes, you do.
It's so critical. For so many years, I've seen so many people with great visions, and they don't have a clue. And that's something that I do as part of my work is, yes, we'll find your vision, and we'll crystallize it, and we'll find your aspirational scenario, but then we'll figure out how to monetize it as well. And I'm sure that's very important to your work as well.
Yes, it is.
So critical. So critical.
You know, and for a lot of reasons. One is that the vision floating out all there, if you can't monetize it, it wears you out. You just give up because it's worn you out. But also it's important that you monetize it because in our society that's how we measure success.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So it's important to do that.
Yes. And to find someone that knows how to help you. That's so critical. For all of us, especially in the 50-plus, now more than ever is find the right people to support you and guide you, whether it's mentoring or whether it's coaching. Just find the right people. This is not something you can do from your everyday consciousness. You need someone else that has that perspective and can shine the light in a way that you can't do on your own, or you can't do with a, you know, a neighbor or a friend or a relative. It's, you need someone who's experienced in this. And buyer beware, unlike Jackie and I, there are a lot of people that are hanging up shingles that should not be.
Yeah.
So be sure it's somebody who knows their stuff and has good references and, you know, is quality. It's really, really, really important.
So we've had a great conversation, Karen. We only have a few minutes left. So
okay.
You have one succinct piece of advice for listeners, somebody, if they're struggling to find their place in the new, you know, longevity economy?
Yes. I would say the one thing is to figure out what your skills are and what they aren't, and then fill the gap.
All right.
That's really critical. The other, I think, is discover what matters to you, but then find where it intersects with what matters to the world around you.
Okay. That's important.
Yes.
And
so
I like
if I
that.
Can, I'd love to also invite people to come to my websites. There's one, Karen Sands, SANDS.com. That's my portal. And to agelessfutures.com, which is definitely for those that are 50-plus and those who seek to serve us.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And you'll find blogs and e-books and regular books and lots of information that's really tremendous, tremendous.
Oh, that's just fabulous, absolutely fabulous. I just so enjoyed listening with you, and, you know, I'm enthused about this, and I
Great.
Think that you are totally, totally on the right track. You know that you are, and I appreciate your being willing to or being able to tie the futurist vision in with very practical advice.
Good.
So, you know, when you can see the long-term trends that are arising and at the same time you can be talking to people about fill the gap, you know, between
right.
what is possible and what matters to you and what is needed in the world, because that's, you know, such basic entrepreneurial advice. So
great.
I would say you're a visionary who's very grounded, and I like that combination.
Thank you.
It's great.
Thank you. I'm glad
so,
we connected, Jackie.
I'm going to have to close us off. We've just had a great discussion. And, Karen, do you want to give your website one more time?
Sure. Karen Sands, SANDS.com, and AgelessFutures, plural, .com.
Yes, I think I'll be on AgelessFutures.com in 15 minutes. Take you there.
Thanks, Jackie.
I love
we'll
it.
We'll continue our dialogue. Thank
so,
you.
So, listeners, I want to remind you that this is Jackie B. Peterson. I'm your host for once a week on Solo Pro Radio, and I'm bringing you very interesting guests, just like Karen this week. And we're talking to solos and encore entrepreneurs, and we're learning about the world that is growing and unfolding for the baby boomer population, which is just fabulous. I want to remind you there's 100 million people in the country over the age of 50.
Yes.
And, you know, with intentional world changing, I can see some fabulous futures for all of us.
Exactly.
And I'm hoping that you will go to my website, bettersmarterrichard.com, and you can download my free ebook about the 7 principles of solopreneurship. You can buy my book, sign up for a study group, and check out the calendar and see all kinds of things that are going on. You can also plug into all the various different podcasts, radio shows that we've had over the last 2.5 years. Lots of interesting conversations. So I look forward to you joining us and becoming part of the Better, Smarter, Richer and Visionaries with Wrinkled tribes that are out there as we move forward and make positive changes in the world. So thanks again, and I'll hear from you. You'll hear from me next week. Goodbye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.